Good morning, dear students. Welcome to another video on History of English Language. We've been doing a series of videos on this particular subject. And in the last video, we discussed about modern English period. So we still have to learn a little bit more about modern English. So this is the second part of modern English period. If you haven't watched the first part, I really advise you to stop this video there here and go back and watch the first part of the modern English period video. So in the last part, we covered certain aspects like the influence of Renaissance on modern English, Reformation, printing press, and great vowel shift. These were the important topics we dealt with in the last video. So I hope that video was beneficial. Let's move on to the next topic of concern, which is spelling reforms. So about English language, what we can say is English language is an unphonetic language. So what is a phonetic language? A phonetic language is a language in which there is an alphabet for a sound. But English language is not like that. There is that problem. There is actually a lack of correlation between spelling and pronunciation in English. So that is why English language is an unphonetic language. So in a perfectly consistent system of spelling, there should be one symbol for one phoneme. Oro shabdathinum adindedayittulla corresponding alphabet ulla or language aanu nammal phonetic language ennu parayunnu. The present English is far from this state. For example, let's look at these words: about, father, neighbor, pleasure, the, theater, etc. In all these words, there is a common sound, which is the weak vowel a. But let's look at how it is represented in spelling. Here it is a, here it is er, here it is or, here it is ure, here it is e, here it is re. In all these different words, the same sound, weak vowel a, is represented using different spelling combinations. Likewise, let us look at these words: about, gate, cat, father, talk. Here there is a common letter, alphabet A. But in all these different words, the alphabet A has got different pronunciation. For example, in about, it is a. In gate, it is a. In cat, it is a. In father, it is ah. In talk, it is aw. So you see the problem with English language. There is a lack of correlation between spelling and pronunciation. Now, why this lack of correlation? Why does English spelling mislead us? One reason is that we overwork the alphabet. First reason is we overwork the alphabet. Because we have 26 letters, but these 26 letters have the burden to represent 44 sounds. Agapada 26 aksharangale ullu, adu vachu 44 shabdangalanu represent cheyanda. So we are actually overworking these 26 letters. So some symbols have to represent more than one sound. So that is one reason why English spelling and pronunciation do not correlate with each other. Let's look at the second reason. So another important reason is that over the last three centuries, English spelling has changed very little, whereas pronunciation is constantly changing. Okay, appa last oru 300 varshamayittu spelling maariyittilla, pakshe pronunciation maarunnundu. So English spelling is therefore set or fixed, whereas pronunciation keeps on changing and it gets farther away from the spelling. So that is one reason. So for the past three centuries, spelling hasn't changed, but pronunciation is constantly changing. Let's look at the next reason. So another reason, the third reason, is that there is more than one system of spelling conventions in English language. There is more than one system of spelling conventions. For example, we have old English systems, we have French conventions, we have Greek conventions, Latin conventions. So, ഈ പല ലാംഗ്വേജിന്റെ കൺവെൻഷൻസ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷിന്റെ സ്പെല്ലിംഗിൽ നമ്മൾ യൂസ് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. ഈ ലാംഗ്വേജസിലൊക്കെ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് എങ്ങനെയാണോ എഴുതുന്നത്, ആ അത് നമ്മളെ ഇംഗ്ലീഷിൽ ഇൻഫ്ലുവൻസ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ, ലെറ്റ്സ് ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ദീസ് ടു വേർഡ്സ്, മൗസ് ആൻഡ് മൈസ്. ദർ ഇസ് എ കോമൺ സൗണ്ട് സ, ബട്ട് ഇൻ മൗസ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് റെപ്രസെൻറ്റഡ് വിത്ത് എസ് ആൻഡ് ഇൻ മൈസ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് റെപ്രസെൻറ്റഡ് വിത്ത് സി. സോ ദി എസ് ഇസ് ടേക്കൺ ഫ്രം ദ നേറ്റീവ് സ്പെല്ലിംഗ്, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ഓൾഡ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് കൺവെൻഷൻ. വെർ ഇസ് ദ സി ഇസ് ടേക്കൺ ഫ്രം ഫ്രഞ്ച് സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് കൺവെൻഷൻ. So there itself you have two different spelling conventions at work. Again, these French people, they tend to pronounce C as sir before front vowels. That has actually influenced our language too. Then again, we have another spelling convention. We have borrowed spelling from Greek conventions. For example, we have words like phone, in which PH, this sound combination represents F. We could easily have written F-O-N-E, but we tend to prefer P-H-O-N-E because that is taken from the Greek spelling convention in words like telephone, philosophy, etc. So you see, there are different spelling conventions at work in English. We have Old English, French, Latin, Greek spelling conventions at work in English language. That might be the reason spelling and pronunciation does not have any correlation. Let's look at the fourth reason why English spelling and pronunciation are far from each other. In English language, there are various provincial dialects. Local aayittulla oru paadu dialects ullu oru language aanu English. And certain pronunciations from these local dialects have passed into standard English pronunciation. ഈവൺ ഈ ലോക്കൽ ഡയലക്ട്സിൽ നിന്നുള്ള ചില പ്രൊനൗൺസിയേഷൻ പോലും സ്റ്റാൻഡേർഡ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് പ്രൊനൗൺസിയേഷനിലേക്ക് കയറി വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. ബട്ട് ദീസ് ഡയലക്ടിക്കൽ പ്രൊനൗൺസിയേഷൻസ്, ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് ഓൾവേസ് റെക്കോർഡഡ് ഇൻ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ്. ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് ഓൾവേസ് റെക്കോർഡഡ് ഇൻ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ്. ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ, ലെറ്റ്സ് ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ദിസ് വേർഡ് ഒ എൻ ഇ. ഇഫ് യു ഹാവ് ടു പ്രൊനൗൺസ് ഇറ്റ്, യു കുഡ് ഹാവ് പ്രൊനൗൺസ്ഡ് ഇറ്റ് ആസ് ഒണി. ബട്ട് വൈ ഇസ് ഇറ്റ് പ്രൊനൗൺസ്ഡ് ഇറ്റ് വിത്ത് എ വ? വൈ ഇസ് ഇറ്റ് കോൾഡ് വൺ? It is taken from some local dialect. Although there is were here, we don't see a W in this word. So we took this pronunciation one from a local dialect, but we did not represent it, record it in spelling. So that is the fourth reason why English spelling does not correlate with pronunciation. Let's look at the fifth reason why there is a lack of correlation between spelling and pronunciation. This is a phenomenon called inverted spellings. Inverted spellings. For example, a sound change takes place. So the change is sometimes recorded in spelling. So a sound change takes place and then it is recorded in spelling. So after the sound change takes place, there will occur two different pronunciations, I mean two different spellings, one with the old pronunciation and one with the new pronunciation. Okay, the inverted spelling ennu parayunnathu oru sound change undai kanju, oru vaakile oru sound change undai kanju, adu chela samayathu adu sound change anusarichu spellingum maattunna oru parivadi vararundu. Pakshe അപ്പൊ നടക്കുന്ന ഒരു കാര്യം എന്താന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ, രണ്ട് സ്പെല്ലിങ് ഒരേ സമയത്ത് നിലനിൽക്കും. പഴയ പ്രൊനൗൺസിയേഷൻ ഉള്ള സ്പെല്ലിങ്ങും പുതിയ പ്രൊനൗൺസിയേഷൻ ഉള്ള സ്പെല്ലിങ്ങും വരും. ബട്ട് ദെൻ വാട്ട് ഹാപ്പൻസ് ഇൻ ദെർ ആർ സെർട്ടൺ റിലേറ്റഡ് വേർഡ്സ് ഇൻ വിച്ച് ദി സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഹാസ് നോട്ട് ടേക്കൺ പ്ലേസ്. ഇപ്പം ഈ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഒറിജിനലി നടന്ന വേർഡുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധമുള്ള വളരെ ക്ലോസ് റിലേഷൻ ഉള്ള ചില വേർഡ്സ് ഉണ്ടാവും, അതിൽ ഈ പറഞ്ഞ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഒന്നും ഉണ്ടായിട്ടുണ്ടാവില്ല. But even in those words, this spelling, this new spelling is applied there too. For example, ninku manasilavan vendi I'll give you an example. This is not a strict example, I am just giving it to you. Okay, it's just a something I came up with myself, so it is not very authoritarian, so don't trust me on this, just to make you understand this better. So we learned in Old English how the word moose turned to mouse. Right. So in moose, there was a sound change. Moose became mouse, and it was represented in spelling too. M-O-U-S-E. അപ്പോൾ ഉ എന്നുള്ളത് മാറി ഔ ആയി. അപ്പോൾ അത് അതിനനുസരിച്ച് സ്പെല്ലിങ്ങും മാറ്റി. ബട്ട് ദെൻ ദർ ഇസ് എ ഡിസേർട്ട് നെയിംഡ് മൂസ്. ഓക്കെ, ചോക്ലേറ്റ് മൂസ് എന്നൊക്കെ കേട്ടിട്ടില്ലേ. സോ ദർ ഇസ് എ ഡിസേർട്ട് നെയിംഡ് മൂസ്. ഇൻ ദിസ് പർട്ടിക്കുലർ വേർഡ് ഡിഡ് ദ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഒക്കെ? നോ, ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് കോൾഡ് മൗസ്, ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് സ്റ്റിൽ മൂസ്. മൂസ് എന്ന് തന്നെയാണ് ഇതിനെ പറയുന്നത്. ചോക്ലേറ്റ് മൂസ്, ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ആക്ച്വലി ക്രീമി. ഇറ്റ്സ് നോട്ട് കേക്ക്, ഇറ്റ്സ് നോട്ട് പുഡിംഗ്, ഇറ്റ്സ് സംതിങ് ഇൻ ബിറ്റ്വീൻ. ഇറ്റ്സ് വെരി ഡെലിഷ്യസ് ടു ഈറ്റ്. സോ ഇൻ ദിസ് പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ വേർഡ് ദർ ഇസ് നോട്ട് സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച്. ദ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഡിഡ് നോട്ട് ഒക്കർ, ബട്ട് സ്റ്റിൽ വി ക്യാൻ സേ ദാറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് വാസ് ഓൾസോ റിട്ടൺ ആസ് മൂസ് ബിഫോർ. ബട്ട് ഈവൻ ദോ ദ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഡിഡ് നോട്ട് ഒക്കർ, ദ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് was changed to M-O-U-S-S-E. So, ആദ്യത്തെ വേർഡിൽ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഉണ്ടായി, രണ്ടാമത്തെ വേർഡിൽ സൗണ്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ഉണ്ടായില്ല. പക്ഷേ ഇതുപോലിരിക്കുന്ന ഒരു വേർഡാണ് രണ്ടാമത്തേത്. അതുകൊണ്ട് ഇതിൽ വന്ന അതേ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് ചേഞ്ച് ഇതിലും നമ്മൾ വരുത്തി. അപ്പോൾ അതിനാണ് ഇൻവേർട്ടഡ് സ്പെല്ലിങ്സ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. സോ ദിസ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് എ വെരി അതോറിറ്റേറിയൻ എക്സാമ്പിൾ ഓഫ് ഇൻവേർട്ടഡ് spellings. It's not authentic at all. It is something I came up with so that you could understand. So what takes place is there will be a sound change, and according to the sound change there will come a new pronunciation. But then in a word related to the original word, the sound change does not take place, but still they change the spelling because they assume that, you know, it is these are related words, so why not just keep it simple like this. So that is inverted spelling. This was a fifth reason why modern English spelling is different from its pronunciation. And another reason, the sixth reason why English spelling and pronunciation do not correlate is because of the influence of spelling reformers. Some people think that pronunciation keeps on changing. Why don't we just change the spelling too? But there are a lot of problems with changing spellings because we have already published millions of books in this planet. So if we have to change the spelling, we have to go back to the ancient times and keep on changing spellings from that time. So it has actually resulted in complicating the system more and more. ഇപ്പോൾ ചില സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് റിഫോമേഴ്സ് വിചാരിക്കും സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് മാറ്റിയാൽ തീരാവുന്ന പ്രശ്നമല്ലേ ഉള്ളൂ എന്ന് വിചാരിക്കും. പക്ഷേ അതിൻ്റെ ഇഫക്റ്റ് ആക്ച്വലി നേരെ ഓപ്പോസിറ്റ് ആയിട്ടാണ് വരുന്നത്. ഇറ്റ് ഹാസ് ആക്ച്വലി ലെഡ് ടു മോർ ആൻഡ് മോർ കോംപ്ലിക്കേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ഇൻകൺസിസ്റ്റൻസി. അഗെയിൻ ദർ ആർ സെർട്ടൻ പ്രോബ്ലംസ് ഓഫ് ചേഞ്ചിങ് ദ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ്. ദർ ആർ സെർട്ടൻ പ്രോബ്ലംസ് ഓഫ് സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് റിഫോംസ് ബിക്കോസ് സം പീപ്പിൾ ബിലീവ് ദാറ്റ് റിഫോം is not the only way of bringing pronunciation and spelling. They think that you can just alter pronunciation, you can just make it agree with spelling. Spelling maatunnathinu varam pronunciation maati spelling il kaanunna pole ippa machine gun ennu ezhuthi machine gunnu vaichcha pore ennu vicharikkunnavarund. Adu pole champagne ennu ezhuthi champagne ennu vaichcha thirunna prashnamalle ullu ennu vicharikkum. So there are many disadvantages of spelling convention, spelling reforms, because the new spelling will have to replace the old spelling, and we have already published a lot of books in this country or in this planet, so it is impossible to go and change the spelling of all these texts we already have. So that brings us to the end of spelling reforms. I hope you have understood this one. Let's move on to the next topic, dictionaries. So dictionaries were first introduced in the Middle Ages, and also during classical ancient period they were used to something called the glossaries or collections of glosses. That's what it was called. So what's the meaning of gloss? Gloss is a Latin term which means a rare word needing special explanation. A rare word needing special explanations. So these earliest glossaries, they dealt only with selected words. വളരെ ചുരുക്കം ചില വാക്കുകൾ മാത്രമേ അതിനകത്ത് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നുള്ളൂ. So there were many glossaries which appeared in Greek and Latin. Slowly, native language words were also gathered in these glossaries. And in 16th century, some crude attempts were made in lexicography. First few dictionaries are these ones. In 1565, Thomas Cooper introduced this book called Thesaurus Linguae Romans et Britannicae. Then in 1604, Robert Cowdery's A Table of Alphabetical English Words came out. In 1658, Edward Phillips' New World of English Words was published. And then there were many etymologies which appeared during this period. You know what etymologies are? Etymologies are collections of words which deals with the historical transformation of meaning. Meaning in the changes. Pala centuries la oru word in the meaning endayirunnu. Adinte source evidunnaanu. Idellam parayna dictionaries naanu etymologies nu parayna. So in 1667 we have an etymology from Stephen Skinner named Etymologicon Linguae Anglicane. In 1677 Francis Junius's Etymologicon Anglicanum was released. And there were some preliminary attempts on lexicography. Proper dictionaries. In 1708, John Kersey's Dictionarium Anglo-Britannicum, or it is also called a General English Dictionary. It was released. In 1730, Nathan Bailey brought out a dictionary called Dictionary. In this particular period, illustrations and quotations were also used. ചെറിയ പടങ്ങളും കൊട്ടേഷൻസും ലിറ്ററേച്ചറിൽ നിന്നൊക്കെയുള്ള കൊട്ടേഷൻസും ഈ ഡിക്ഷണറീസിൽ യൂസ് ചെയ്യുന്നു. ആൻഡ് 1755 ഇസ് എ വെരി ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻറ്റ് പീരിയഡ് ഫോർ അസ് ബിക്കോസ് ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വെൻ സാമുവൽ ജോൺസൺ ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ്ഡ് ഹിസ് ഡിക്ഷണറി ഓഫ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ലാംഗ്വേജ്. ദ സ്പെഷ്യാലിറ്റി ഓഫ് ദിസ് ഡിക്ഷണറി ഇസ് ദാറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് ഹാഡ് മെനി ഇലസ്ട്രേറ്റീവ് കൊട്ടേഷൻസ്. ഇറ്റ് വാസ് വെരി ക്ലിയർ, കൺസൈസ്, and it also had very effective scholarly definitions because Samuel Johnson was a scholar. He also provided many scholarly definitions. But if you look at some explanations, some are marred by personal bias. And personal aayittulla chela biases chela idilakku vannittundu. For example, he did not like lizards at all. So he defines lizard as an animal representing a serpent with legs added to it. There are some other interesting illustrations or definitions by him. For example, lunch. For him, lunch was as much food as one's hand can hold. നമ്മുടെ കയ്യിൽ ഒതുങ്ങുന്ന അത്രയും ഫുഡ്, അതിനാണ് ലഞ്ച്. അപ്പൊ ലഞ്ച് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ ക്വാണ്ടിറ്റി ആയിരുന്നു പുള്ളിക്ക്, അതിന്റെ സമയം അല്ലായിരുന്നു. അതുപോലെ ഹി ഡിഫൈൻഡ് സിഗരറ്റ് ആസ് എ ട്യൂബ് ഓർ സംതിങ് എ പൈപ്പ് വിത്ത് ഫയർ ഓൺ വൺ എൻഡ് ആൻഡ് എ ഫൂൾ ഓൺ ദി അതർ എൻഡ് ബിക്കോസ് ഹി ഹേറ്റഡ് സിഗരറ്റ് സ്മോക്കേഴ്സ് അപ്പാരന്റ്ലി. സോ ദർ ആർ സം വെരി വണ്ടർഫുൾ എക്സ്പ്ലനേഷൻസ് ലൈക്ക് ദിസ്. ഓൾസോ സാമുവൽ ജോൺസൺസ് ഡിക്ഷണറി അറ്റംപ്റ്റ്സ് ടു ഫിക്സ് ദ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് ആൻഡ് പ്രൊനൗൺസിയേഷൻ. ഇറ്റ് വാസ് മോർ ഓർ ലെസ് എ വെരി ഓതെന്റിക് ഡിക്ഷണറി. സോ സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് ആക്ച്വലി വാസ് it had a tendency to be fixed by this point. And let's look at the other dictionaries which were influential after this. In 1836, Charles Richardson's A New Dictionary of English Language was released. In this dictionary also, he has provided historical uses of words or the meanings which these words had in older stages of language and also in the contemporary sense, more like an etymology. Then in 1842, it's an important year. It's the year in which Philological Society was formed. And they brought out this dictionary, A New English Dictionary on Historical Principles, or we know it better as the Oxford English Dictionary. So the original work began in 1883, but it was finished only in 1928. The editor of Oxford English Dictionary was Sir James Murray. It had 4,14,825 words and 18,27,306 quotations. And it provided definitions and historical changes of meaning. And also it provided pronunciations with phonetic script. And also another important factor about Oxford English Dictionary is that They also included slang terms and casual words in addition to other words. And it was presented to King George V. And this was in England. And in America, it was presented to the American president, Calvin Coolidge. Let's look at other dictionaries. Daniel Jones's an English pronunciation dictionary is very important for us. And there are some American dictionaries. For example, in 1806, Noah Webster came out with his compendious English dictionary. Again, 1928, Webster's American Dictionary was released. 1864 saw the publication of an American Dictionary of the English Language. And in 1909, we see Webster's New International Dictionary coming out. So that brings us to the end of the lesson on dictionaries. Now let's go to our next topic, which is the makers of English. So we can see that authors can influence language in many ways because literature and language is really related to each other. So an author can directly influence the language. He could introduce new words. Also, he could give new uses to existing words. And also he can give wide currency to a new word, a new form of expression, which might already exist in a language, or he might actually even introduce his own new expressions. Let's look at some makers of English. First of all, we can't forget William Shakespeare. So he is one of the masters of literature. He has also contributed to the making of English language. So the name of Shakespeare is of paramount importance as we are students of language and literature. So he had great influence on language. This we can know by the amount of words and expressions he has added to the vocabulary. So English language il orubada words and expressions Shakespeare add cheedittundu. So he has been influenced by a lot of other sources around him. So after Bible, we can say that Shakespeare's literature was something which influenced English language a lot. So he has experimented with a lot of stuff like linguistic innovations, dialectical adaptations, archaisms, that is old words and old usages, etc. So I have divided it into different classifications. Let's look at all these. So some of the dialect words he has used are mobled. He uses in Hamlet. Fees means to drive something or someone away in Taming of the Shrew. And then another expression he has introduced from dialectical words is speak within door in Othello. And then another word is dwindle. It is used in Macbeth. It means to waste away. It is a West Midland word. He has also used expressions taken from spoken language. നമ്മുടെ സംസാര ഭാഷയിൽ വരുന്ന ചില എക്സ്പ്രഷൻസും ചില വേർഡ്സും ഒക്കെ പുള്ളി ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. Some words are actually, it might have been borrowed from him. Some words he coined it himself. Let's look at some of these words. Control, credent, homekeeping, illume, lonely, orb, bump, castigate, incarnadine, what the dickens. These are all some expressions and words he has introduced. He might have borrowed these or coined it himself. And he has introduced some words and phrases which became extremely popular in English. Let's read some of these. Past praying for, like patience on a monument, to the matter born, hoist with his own petard, caught in one's own trap. That's the meaning of this. To be or not to be. Caviar to the general, that means common multitude, too solid flesh, stale, flat and unprofitable, mind's eye, manakkannu ennokke parayile, more in sorrow than anger, the primrose path, rich not gaudy, with all my imperfections on my head, still harping on, the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, there's the rub, this mortal coil, the undiscovered county, the observed of all observers, to hold the mirror up to nature, very like a whale, to speak daggers, a king of shreds and patches, cruel only to be kind, to cudgel one's brains, chap fallen, ministering angel, sweets to the sweet, towering passion, a very palpable hit, to wear one's heart upon one's sleeve, a pound of flesh, a tower of strength, full of the milk of human kindness, the seeds of time. A Daniel came to judgment, yeoman's service, curled darlings, moving accident, summer seeming lust, the guest of summer, a triton among the minnows. These are some of the important words and phrases. We even identify some of these actually. For example, to be or not to be. Very famous soliloquy from Hamlet. And there are many phrases from that particular soliloquy itself here. And then 1 pound of flesh from Merchant of Venice. So there are many expressions, phrases which are very familiar to us. And then another factor about Shakespeare is that he formed new compounds. He took liberties in using one part of speech for another. We learned about it. It's called conversion. You use one part of speech word as another part of speech. Let's look at some of the compounds he has created. For example, he used the French prefixes M and N to coin new words. For example, these are some words he has coined: enact, enchafed, enchased, endeared, engird, enkindle, enlink, enmesh, enrooted, ensky, entame, embattle, embade, empson. And then he has pointed, he has coined some adjectives, some poetic compounds out of adjectives like daring, hardy. And he used some adjectives as verbs, like to make safe. Safe is an adjective, but he uses it as a verb here. He uses nouns as verb, like spaniel. Spaniel is a kind of dog. So if I see you spaniel me, that means you are following me around or something. So also childed. I childed my father because when I was born, he became a father, right? And he fathered me. These are nouns which are used as verbs. And he also used the prefix un to form new words like unavoided, unfellowed, ungod, unhair, unkiss, etc. I don't understand how you can unkiss anybody, but that is something Shakespeare introduced. And then he also used compounds using, he formed compounds using out. For example, outnumber, outlive, and to out Herod, Herod. Herod was a very famous king during the time Jesus Christ was born. He ordered all the babies under the age of 2 to be killed. So he was that much of a cruel man. So to out Herod, Herod, you have to be even more cruel. So that is what he means here. So these are some of the contributions of Shakespeare to English language. Let's look at Geoffrey Chaucer now. So he is described as the first idiom of the English tongue. And he's also called the well of English undefiled. So his influence on English language is undoubted. He has proved it in many instances. So he lived before the age of printing. So we cannot know for certain how much of a contribution he has made to English vocabulary. But we can still come up with some of his contributions. For example, he wrote in East Midland dialect. So he was a court poet. He was the greatest poet of the day. So because he wrote in East Midland dialect, that dialect became very famous. And it was considered to be the standard dialect. So Chaucer's paramount influence is that he paved the way for a standard language. And another thing is his language is replete with a large amount of French. We can see French influence in his language. Again, in his language, we can see modern English grammar in its making. For example, inflections are not that much pronounced in his language. Then he uses S to signify plurals, to denote plurals for nouns. And then the kind of adjectives he uses, it is near to modern English. Again, he uses the definite article the. Then pronouns are also, the kind of pronouns he uses are also closer to modern English. So in all these aspects, we can see modern English grammar in making. Then Chaucer, in Chaucer's poetry, word order is loose and conversational. It was not very rigid. It was loose and conversational. It did not have rigidity or strict regularity. So English was still in the stage of transition at that point. English ingane maarikondirikkunna oru samayayirunnu. Chaucer vannathu kaaranam there was a process of standardization. It had not begun, but still he has done enough to standardize the language. So through his language we can understand how English language is going to be much simpler. Okay. Let's look at Edmund Spenser now. Spenser is considered as the poet's poet. So his influence is very easy to trace than that of Shakespeare. So in his language, we can actually divide language into two kinds of language: literary language and colloquial language. എഴുതാൻ ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്ന ലാംഗ്വേജ് വേറെ, സംസാരിക്കാൻ ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്ന ലാംഗ്വേജ് വേറെ. അങ്ങനെ ഒരു ഡിവിഷൻ വന്നത് എഡ്മണ്ട് സ്പെൻസറിൻ്റെ ലാംഗ്വേജിലാണ്. സോ ചോസർ ആക്ച്വലി റോട്ട് ഇൻ ദി ഓർഡിനറി ലാംഗ്വേജ് ഓഫ് ഹിസ് ടൈം. And he never consciously invented new words, but Spenser actually deliberately framed an artificial kind of dialect to write poetry. Poems ezhuthan vendittu mathram pulli oru artificial aayittulla oru pudhiya oru dialect thanne kandupidichu. For example, he revived some old words. These are some words which he derived: need means, brent, uncouth, housing, for. Then crest, reed, raft, astound, blameful, displeasance, en route, doom, forby, implied, nathless, mickle, vile air. Vile air means a while before. Then he made some new coinages like elfin, blatant, askew, filch, flout, freak, belly bone, braggadocio, chirrup, corset, delve, dit, which means song. Also he made some compounds like screws, screw plus squeeze, screws. Then squall means cry, wrinkled means wrinkled. Then he also adapted some old words like baneful, briny, changeful, drear, hapless, autumn, sunshiny, wolfish, etc. And even Spenser used one grammatical category as another. For example, the adverb most is used by him as an adjective. The adjective fair is used by him as adverb. And the adjective weak is used as noun. So he used language in those ways. So Spenser's efforts were actually in the production of a poetic dictionary. പോയട്രി എഴുതാൻ വേണ്ടി പുതിയൊരു തരത്തിലുള്ള ഒരു ലാംഗ്വേജ് തന്നെ ഉണ്ടാക്കിയെടുക്കുക എന്നുള്ളതായിരുന്നു പുള്ളിയുടെ മെയിൻ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ശ്രമം. ലെറ്റ്സ് ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ജോൺ മിൽട്ടൺ നൗ. ജോൺ മിൽട്ടൺ ഹി എൻജോയ്സ് എൻ ഔട്ട്സ്റ്റാൻഡിംഗ് പൊസിഷൻ ഇൻ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ. ഹി ഈസ് നോൺ ആസ് എ മോൾഡർ ആൻഡ് എക്സെംപ്ലാർ ഓഫ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് പോയറ്റിക് ഡിക്ഷൻ. അപ്പോൾ ഒരു പോയറ്റിക് ലാംഗ്വേജ് കറക്റ്റായിട്ട് ഉണ്ടാക്കിയെടുക്കാൻ വേണ്ടി മിൽട്ടൺ ഒരുപാട് ശ്രമിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. സോ ഹി എക്സ്പെരിമെൻറ്റഡ് വിത്ത് സ്പെല്ലിംഗ് ഇൻ ഹിസ് പോയട്രി. വി ക്യാൻ സീ ദാറ്റ്. ആൻഡ് ഹി വാസ് എ വെരി കീൻ സ്റ്റുഡൻറ്റ് ഓഫ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ലാംഗ്വേജ്. ഹി വാസ് ഓൾസോ വെരി ഗുഡ് പ്രാക്ടീഷണർ ഓഫ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ലാംഗ്വേജ്. സോ ഹി ഹാസ് കോൺട്രിബ്യൂട്ടഡ് എ ലാർജ് നമ്പർ ഓഫ് വേർഡ്സ് ടു ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ലാംഗ്വേജ്. സം ഓഫ് ദീസ് വേർഡ്സ് വർ ലേണഡ് ഫ്രം ഹിം ബൈ ഹിം ഫ്രം അതർ ലാംഗ്വേജസ് ഓർ അതർ റൈറ്റേഴ്സ്. And most of these words were poetic in nature. They have contributed to the literary vocabulary of English. But in modern day, only a very few Miltonic words and phrases have become part of the English word stock. That is because Shakespeare naana ethom kudal nammal importance koduthirulla, especially ordinary man has given more importance to Shakespeare and his language, whereas Milton's diction or language was read only by scholars. So that is why Shakespeare was more popular than Milton. Not everybody could understand Milton because he was a scholar poet. Let's look at some contributions of Milton. He has coined some words and expressions. Let's look at these: gorgeous east, barbaric pearl and gold, a pillar of state, darkness visible, confusion worse confounded, to prove a bitter morsel, to hide one's diminished head, human face divine, the last infirmity of noble minds, to scorn delights and live laborious days, calm of mind all passion spent, fresh woods and pastures new, udiya mechil purangal thedi. Pandemonium. Pandemonium means utter confusion. Anarch. These are some words which he introduced. He coined these words and expressions. And some familiar words like anarchy, Olympian, Titanic. These were actually popularized by him. And also some Latin words like argument, grateful, virtue were popularized by him. Some archaism, old words and dialect words were brought forth by him, like clomb, scrannel, frore, wraith, etc. Wraith is used to form wrath, as a form of wrath. Okay. And then in spelling also he has experimented a lot. Instead of sovereign, he wrote sovereign. You know, it's more closer to pronunciation. He wrote island like this, I-L-A-N-D. Dropped was written D-R-O-P-T. Walked, dressed, etc. And then he experimented with words like these. Heaven was written H-E-A-V apostrophe N. So these are some of the contributions of John Milton to English language. And now let's look at the influence of Bible on modern English. So let's look at the various Bible translations. Bible is the most widely read and the most frequently quoted of all books. It's the book that sells the most all the countries in the globe itself. So its influence, it has been recognized by men like Tennyson, Macaulay, Carlyle, Huxley and other literary people. And Bible had a formative influence on the style of many such authors. It has provided us with a lot of new words which were adopted into the spoken language even. So when we talk about Bible translation, first of all, we have to deal with the translation by John Wycliffe. Who is John Wycliffe? He is the founder of the Lollard movement. He was the first person to translate Bible into English. So he used the Latin Vulgate of Saint Jerome. He translated from the original Latin version of Saint Jerome to English. A very important phrase from this translation is "under the sweat of thy brow." Under the sweat of thy brow. Let's look at the next translation. This is a translation by William Tyndale. It came out in 1526. Now William Tyndale, he had this genius for the telling phrase. He made wonderful, beautiful phrases and idioms. These were filled with meaning. These phrases were pregnant with meaning. But still, it came across as beautiful in rendering. That is what is very characteristic of William Tyndale. So a great deal of his phrases have remained as part of the authorized version. It has gone from this translation to the authorized version of Bible. And what he translated from was the New Testament in Hebrew. So this guy, William Tyndale, translated the New Testament from Hebrew, where Wycliffe translated from Latin Vulgate. So William Tyndale was also influenced by Martin Luther. Let's look at some words and phrases which William Tyndale has introduced. Scapegoat, Belliard, glad tidings, beautiful. Now, this is a word which was coined by William Tyndale. A beautiful word, beautiful. Trespass, congregation, elders, peacemaker, long suffering, ungodliness, weakling, stumbling block, godly. Burden and heat of the day, eat, drink and be merry, the powers that be. These are words and phrases which became very popular in English vocabulary. Let's look at the next translation. This is a translation by Miles Coverdale in 1535. So this was the first complete modern English translation of Bible. All the others were, this was just New Testament. This was also just a part of the Bible. whereas Miles Coverdale's version was the first complete modern English translation of Bible. It was actually based on Tyndale's translation. And we get a lot of wonderful words and phrases like loving kindness. Loving kindness is, there is a Greek word called agape. In Greek, they have different words for different kinds of love. Like there is eros, which is a romantic and sexual kind of love between lovers, husband and wife. And then there is a kind of love between brothers and sisters called philia. And agape is a kind of love which God has for us, or we could have for God. It's more like a spiritual love. But there was no equivalent in English language. That is why Miles Coverdale came up with this phrase, loving kindness means agape. Then another phrase was tender mercy, tender hearted, avenger of blood, samhara dudan ennanu parayum, the valley of the shadow of death, marana nidalin taalvara, morning star, that's another name for Lucifer, broken hearted, blood guiltiness, mess of putte, sweat of thy brow. These are all words and phrases coined by Miles Coverdale. And let's look at the authorized version of the Bible, which came out in 1611. The work began in 1604 and it was completed only in 1611. And it is the third translation of Bible into English, which was approved by English church authorities. It did not provide any new words to the English vocabulary, but it preserved a lot of older words like damsel, travail, firmament, raiment, fatted calf, eat, drink and be merry, the burden and heat of the day, apparel, list, which means desire. These words might have died off if not for the authorized version. And there are many phrases which found their way into the language from authorized version, were phrases like a labor of love, clear as crystal, the still small voice, a thorn in the flesh, the 11th hour, the shadow of death, a howling wilderness, the old Adam, the salt of the earth, to wash our hands off, the holy of holies, the lesser lights, that means the stars and moon, the olive branch, a peace offering, a perfect Babel, a painted Jezebel, to cast pearls before swine, the worship of mammon, a leviathan ship, etc. These are some phrases which have found their way into English language. And the general contribution of the English language was that the use of words and phrases through misunderstanding. For example, to see eye to eye. Kannu nere kaanilla ennu parayunna. Adupole, there was another word. It means help meet. Actually, you will have your help meet you. God says that to Adam. He means that a woman who will be of help to you will meet you. But we misunderstood the word help meet as another word for wife. So this is through misunderstanding. So help meet means wife or partner. Also, yeomen, like common men, learned language through reading Bible. So it has actually, Bible has fixed the language. So everyone in their households, they had this habit of reading Bible at a fixed time. They listened to it on every Sunday. And this book became so familiar, people started using the phrases in their day-to-day life. So that brings us to the end of the lesson on modern English period. So we have covered a lot of portions here. So we learned about the historical background of modern English, the influence of Renaissance, Reformation, printing press. We learned about great vowel shift and we learned about the spelling reforms, dictionaries, makers of English, under which we learned William Shakespeare's contributions, Geoffrey Chaucer, Edmund Spenser, John Milton, etc. And finally, we learned about the different translations of Bible. And that brings us to the end of the lesson on modern English period. I hope this has been beneficial to you. And wait for my next video for further details about history of English language. Thank you for watching. Bye.